Just wait a second.
The Crash Course Live is presented by Smash It Demolition Derby and the 2016 Basher Cat. Demo Derby Masters. Winter Slam 2016. Ultimate Derby and Blizzard Bash in Capital City Carnage. Sciopa Racing and SciopaRacing.com. Reckless Abandon Derby Apparel at RecklessAbandonGear.com. And Derby Inc. Magazine. Live it, breathe it, be it, Derby Inc. This is the Crash Course Demolition Derby Podcast, recorded live at the FingerLakes1.com studios in downtown Seneca Falls, New York. And now your host, Chris Marquardt.
Good afternoon, good evening. Welcome to Crash Course Podcast, episode number 176. Joining us on the line already, we're going to be catching up with Jeremy Gulley and Justin Hartmann regarding FTR Spring Showdown coming up just in a couple weeks at the Booneville Onieda County Fairgrounds in Booneville, New York. Those guys, can you hear me okay, fellas?
Yep, yeah.
All right, perfect. Jeremy, I know you're going to be working close with this one. You're also going to be hanging out with all the guys from FTR. I think the chair just failed. There we go. All those guys from FTR on this show, and that's going to be sort of the official kickoff for both of your seasons. You guys are going to be from there being pretty busy, both driving cars and working with additional shows. How's everything coming together at this point so far for year two for the FTR event?
We're just buttoning up things and getting some car counts together and trying to do some last minute touches. It's 3 weeks out, but we're trying not to wait to the last absolute minute this year.
Yeah, all the same, you know, the late coming together, Justin. But all the same, last year was a pretty good success for the initial run.
Yeah, we tried to prepare ourselves as much as possible, but we didn't quite expect the turnout that we had last year, so that was good.
Given that you guys have had more time, what's something that you've put your attention to in terms of making sure that this year is better than last year?
Well, first of all, probably be more air horns and flags. We kind of missed out on those last year. But as far as anything else, we didn't really have too many complaints as far as anything else went. We're going to pay back the fifth place this year, so everybody has a chance to try to get something back.
Mm-hmm. That was that something that came up in conversations, or is that just something that you're going to be able to do now that you've got more time to plan out the show and act more as promoters in terms of drawing more car count?
Yeah, now that we kind of have a number to go off from now, we kind of mm-hmm. can plan a little better on what to expect.
Sure. In terms of the show last year was a pretty good success, all things considered. You know, in terms of the car count, you guys had a strong showing. It put you guys, if I remember right, it put you guys in the top 10 for New York State as a whole in terms of overall car count. And that was just essentially by a little bit of word of mouth and a fairly short schedule. What's the feedback that you guys have been getting this year in terms of the conversations that you've been having with drivers, and are you seeing a lot of new names coming up on the entry lists?
Not really a lot of new names on the entry list. I get those, but there is a lot of questions coming in from drivers that maybe haven't signed up yet that weren't there last year or that just came and watched last year.
I got a lot of those people that just came and watched last year that are going to actually drive a car this year.
Right. A lot of those just the feeling it out type trip that year one, they want to see how inspection goes. They want to see what the rule book reads like compared to what's actually enforced or not enforced.
That's the way we kind of all do it, isn't it? you don't ever go to a show. Normally, you don't just build a car and go to a show. You always go and at least one or two guys that you know might run it, but you go and look at it and see the quality of the show and the quality of the inspection, and then you make your mind up whether you're going to, put that on your schedule to run the following year.
And if I remember right, this one is going to pay. It's $1,200 for $1,000 for the 20 car limited weld main. What else is on the schedule for that? I know you guys have got a good population of compacts that made it to the show last year.
As far as the limited weld, we're gonna for first place it's gonna be $1,500 and $500 for second, and all these payouts are guaranteed no matter what the car count is. For economy V8, it's $1,200 for first, $600 for second, $300 for first, $150 for fourth, and $50 for fifth. Compact, it's $1,000 for first, $500 for second, $250 for third, $100 for fourth, and $50 for fifth. We'll also be running the truck. We're going to have $500 for first place winner. But with that, we're going to have a $300 gift certificate for Catskill Fabrication and Performance from Ryan Holmstrander.
Ryan's everywhere, isn't he? that guy's involved with so much. he's a good guy to have on your side, too. Makes some awesome stuff.
He helped us out last year, I believe, with a EFI gas tank for a Mad Dog sponsor.
In terms of the truck side of things, I know my familiarity with trucks and what Jeremy's been around a lot are the trucks like what we see run at the Otsego County Fairgrounds and the Madison County Fairgrounds, Brookville, and Morris, New York. Where do your truck rules fall?
The truck rules are the spinning wheels rules. They'll run the same same rules as Morris, GDF, Owensdale, Booneville, the Spring Fling Show. They'll all be 100% exactly the same.
You know, what's the feedback been on that? That's one of those things that a lot of guys have sort of been asking for indirectly, wanting something that's more unified, something that's more consistent from event to event. We've got a lot of promoters that are in that neck of the woods or that have moved through that neck of the woods, but by the same token, you're branching out a little bit further, reaching into New York and Pennsylvania. With our promoter base out there, you know, we've seen some changeover in some of the promoters, but they had different rules for different shows depending on where they went and what their driver base wanted. The response been pretty strong of having a uniform rule book for all of the spinning wheel shows at this point, Jeremy. Seems like we may have lost them. I know we're going to be trying to get a hold of Ron McClung here as well. Ron coming away with one of the Mad Dog Awards in Evansville at Urban Destruction. Trying to locate his phone number so that in the event that we did lose those guys, we can jump on the phone with Ron and have a conversation with him. Let's see. So it does look like we've lost them. I'm going to go ahead and give Ron a call while we work on streamlining the process with Jeremy and everybody out in out in Long Eddy. Never fails that we have the most trouble with the shows when nobody else is here. Hey, Ron, let me put you in real quick. So Ron McClung joining us here on the hotline. Ron, man, how are you?
I'm doing good.
That's good. Good to talk with you. You're fresh off of your epic journey to Evansville, Indiana, and you've been a busy guy early this year already.
Yeah, I love to smash cars, and I don't mind traveling. And got a new truck about 8 weeks ago, and I've already got 29,000 kilometers on it.
Which translates to how many miles? About?
I think it's close to 20,000.
that's insane. Because you've been at pretty much every big derby that we've had so far through the early part of the spring.
Yeah, I don't think I've missed any, really, other than Capital City Carnage, which I planned on going to, but we're building cars for the upcoming derbies.
Are you bringing anything back home from these shows? I mean, I'm seeing your name circulating a lot close to the Mad Dog Awards and things along those lines.
Yeah, I got Mad Dog in the Heat at Urban Destruction, and I thought I had it in the feature, but I was runner-up to the guy from Utah with the X8 car.
Derek Shelley.
1960 Lincoln, and man, that thing was bad.
That's,
I seen him coming at me one time, and I got out of his way, thank God.
So take me through a little bit of this and what the process is like trying to get to all these shows, you know, building cars. You're picking your division, so you're not having a ton of time sunk into building the cars and things along those lines. You're able to go out there and you have such disregard for your own welfare and the car that you're bringing home that you just run hard every time. There's not necessarily a lot of car to run again, per se. Tell me about like your decision to go in on this and make this thing a reality, because you're covering so many miles and you're at every big show.
Yeah, I like to build old iron cars,
mm-hmm.
which are pretty easy, and right. I've been trying to pick a lot of the cars that will have a drivetrain in them so I can run what they came with.
Right.
We do have good derby motors, and I do put some motors in certain cars, and I just like to go out and smash stuff. I like my 4.6 Vix, mm-hmm. and if I go to derbies that are really far away, I'll build a disposable car, and I'll leave it there, and I'll come home with something rust-free and clean.
Is it hard to come across cars? I mean, if you watch your Facebook page, you're always bringing something in, and sometimes it's one of those old iron gems that you don't expect to find in Canada, and sometimes it's your typical 98 to 02 or 03 and newer Crown Vicks.
Well, I've been doing it for so long that I travel all over the place, and I'm always on the hunt for cars, and I leave my phone number with people, and I've had people call me from 10 years past saying, hey, do you still derby? Are you still interested in my old station wagon? Because I'm done with it, and you can come and get it. And I'm lucky that way. And just traveling around, you spot stuff in places where you wouldn't think there would be old cars. And
right.
I've learned that if you see something, buy it, because it won't be there tomorrow.
Right. Now, that wagon, is that in reference to the roundback that you just drug home here recently?
Yeah, that was kind of a strange deal that I traded a Pacer for it.
What?
So
wait a minute.
I'll do that deal every week.
You traded a Pacer for a roundback?
Yes.
Straight up. Even trade.
Pretty well, no, it was better on my part because I got a southern front clip and southern doors and a second bumper with the wagon.
Now, can you even run those Pacers up there in Canada? I thought that was primarily a front wheel drive with a wheelbase rule where you couldn't run anything like that up there.
Well, there's one derby
Oh, you can.
Impact will allow the Pacers to run. And we built a 4.3 Pacer, and my son drove it, and he clobbered everything that he got near with that car, and it's still around.
Holy cow.
It just doesn't move.
Right. The Pacer that you traded away, now, did that go with bumpers or not? Because I've seen you do some damage with the AMC bumpers on your Crown Vicks.
I left the bumpers on
it. You did.
It's actually a nice car, and they're going to drive it on the roads.
So. Oh, no kidding. That's interesting. So,
but I do like the Pacer bumpers, though. They're nice, solid beam, and they're easy to bolt on anything.
Now, so you talked about this call out of the blue from 10 years ago that got you a wagon. What wagon was that?
It was a 1976 custom cruiser wagon with a 455. It was an old German lady. And I would go by once a year, and I'd just wave at her and say, I'm still here. I know it's there. And I bought it off of her, and I actually won the last old iron show we had at Western Fair with it. And I think I got 3 wins out of that car.
It's not a bad car right there. Is that thing still around with awesome the trophy sitting on it? Or did you scrap it?
That car's long gone, yeah.
Yeah. So your car of choice to take out to Urban Destruction was a Chrysler product. I was a little surprised to see that.
Yeah, I was saving that car for Spring X, and I was going to take a Suicide Lincoln to Urban Destruction to be a part of. I knew Santel would probably show up with one, and Rick Clark was showing up with a Suicide, and I wanted to be with the cool kids. And we got into an extreme two-man team show with Jeremy Gulley, and me and my son are going to take the Suicide there.
Oh, man, that's going to be fun. That's the one as part of San Filippo?
Yes.
Excellent. So what are some of your thoughts on that extreme class?
He won't let me have the pedals.
Why?
I'm only allowed to have the steering wheel.
No. Why is that?
Because he thinks I'll dunk it in 2 minutes.
We talked a little about Urban Destruction. Lloyd Kirk, Crickham winning that one in a wagon. Todd Robinson picking up second place. Don Santel third. And, again, in one of those old iron entries that Ron was talking about. How was that show as a whole? I mean, that was it seemed like it was pretty well received. A lot of good buzz about the show online. How was Urban Destruction from your point of view?
First thing, the weather was fantastic. It wasn't freezing like it was last year.
Right.
Brandon Dixon and his crew, they put on a good show. The inspection is really fair. They get after people. If you're overboard, they make you cut. They don't let anybody get away with stuff.
Right.
And I was a little kind of worried about running against the metric cars with our old iron, figuring they'd eat us up. But, hey, an old iron car won it. And I love to see the roundbacks. Win derbies. I don't like seeing roundbacks and derbies anymore. That's why I'm saving all of mine. But I was really surprised that an old iron car came out with the win. With the rules that the metric cars had, they could do more work to their cars than what we could do to our cars.
Right. But is that necessarily is it an advantage by doing that kind of work to the new style cars, given that all those things that we've always talked about with the frames being different, we got different thicknesses, the steel's a different type of material, it just tends to bend different. Is it necessarily an advantage with the rule package that they had there?
I really believe it was, because they were allowed hump plates and everything.
Sure.
And there was 3 heats of metric cars and only 2 heats of old school cars, so they could have actually put a $10,000 show on just with the metric cars alone.
Wow.
And in the end, it worked out great. You know, there was lots of hard hitting from the old cars and the metric cars. And I got triple teamed there in the feature, and I couldn't battle them out, and I got put up on the berm. And, you know, it's disappointing to go out that way, but I had a blast. And I'm really surprised how that old iron Chrysler held up. It took quite a beating, and it put out a bit of a beating, too.
You going to run more of them?
I'm actually on my way right now. I'm headed out to look at a 1975 Newport four-door.
Right. Good choice.
So hopefully if I pick that up, it'll be next in line, or it'll be my Bash wire car.
You thought at all about taking that back bumper off of those?
The Newport actually being used, it's kind of like hitting a wall, and it's kind of like a sponge, and they can't do much more damage.
Okay.
And when you leave all that open, serrated metal there, nobody kind of wants to come near you. So it's kind of an advantage.
I see. I know Josh swears by taking the back bumper off of those because they tend to want to go at the window versus when the bumper's on it versus having the bumper off, and it just kind of lets the rails go in over the top of themselves, and the trunk tends to hold together better. How about, I know that's not necessarily your wheelhouse car, but where did that car fall in terms of the likelihood that you'd run it again, given that you're going to look at one?
I've derbied so many cars in the past years, like the racetrack derbies on pavement. I would take any car if it had a running motor, and I wouldn't care if it was a 383, a 440, or a 350 Chevy wagon. It didn't matter what it was, a 425 Cadillac. Just smash them all.
How difficult is it, as much as you go in and out of Canada with cars with no glass on them, do you ever get stopped? They get they inspect it. They wonder what's going on. Do they ask you any questions, or is it pretty routine at this point?
Since your new president got elected, it's getting a little tougher for us. They ask more questions. And taking the Derby cars across, as long as you got a title or the ownership, you're pretty good.
Yeah.
Coming back through Canada, they want to make sure that that's a Canadian car and that you didn't buy it down there, because they want some tax money out of it if you did buy it.
Sure.
Most of the time, they want to come along and watch the show, and most people know what demolition derbies are and like to see it. So,
how many times do you get stopped?
You do get the odd bad guard who wants to go. They can choose their rules to make it easy for you or make it hard on you.
Right. What percentage of the guards at the border stop and instead of trying to inspect your car or inspect your trailer, making sure you're not doing anything illicit, they're just stopping to get Ronnie's autograph?
I haven't had that yet.
So, no.
But that'd be funny. It's a lot of them. I've had a couple guards lately that said, I used to derby, but we don't have it at our fair no more. Died off and there's no money in our town. And that was kind of, I think it was Midland, Michigan. There's a couple of guards there that they run derbies all the time. And they see me coming, hey, weren't you here last week in an LTD? And I said, yep. I said, I'll see you in 2 weeks. I'll have a Cadillac on the trailer.
Is that one of the reasons that you run the way that you do, so that you don't have to contend with the border? I mean, I've seen you make some remarkably impressive shots wide open, but I've also seen you make some strategic shots at a high rate of speed. Is it a case where you just rather go out there and junk the car and have to worry about messing around with the money at the border, and you don't want to have to deal with the cash flow part of it?
I wish I could deal with the cash flow part of it, but I'm a derby guy. I'm not a chess player.
Right.
And to me, demolition derby is about smashing up cars. People pay good money to go and watch us, and I like to paint my cars up. This time I didn't get to paint it up, but thank God there's guys up there that make door wraps and make the cars look pretty, and you can just stick it on and go. But I start out calm until somebody hits my light switch, and then it's all about junking the car, and it don't matter. I have lots of trophies. I don't like cleaning them anymore.
Does your boy ever get after you, saying that you should run smarter?
Yeah.
Yeah.
He writes me hard. He tells me, what did I do that for? Why do I drive like that? And once in a while, he says that I was driving like Rick Clark, and Rick Clark was driving like me. And once in a while, he's proud of me, but not often.
Oh, come on. I mean, it's you're a lot of fun to watch, but you brought up Rick Clark, and we've seen Rick Clark win some outstanding derbies and defy odds like crazy. You're sort of the polar opposite to him. You're just out there to send it as quickly as possible. It's almost a game. The stopwatch starts as soon as the green flag comes out, and you want to wreck that car as fast as possible.
Yeah, that's for sure. Me and Gumby had a thing going where I said I would junk my car in 8 minutes. He says, well, I got you beat. I'm going to junk mine in 5.
Who won? Who won?
He won.
He did.
He was out a lot faster than I was.
Yeah, he brought the pre-run car that he ran in Topeka, if I remember correctly.
He had a green station wagon.
Yeah, I think that was a car that he had at Blizzard Bash a couple years ago, if I remember. Memory serves correct.
He lost the rad fast. It got hot and it wouldn't go. So he says his motors aren't built to run hot, they just run fast.
That's Utah style. That's pretty common out there. They don't have to worry about radiators because they're not going to be on the track much more than 5 or 6 minutes, no matter what they're doing.
That's for sure. He's a great guy. I was glad to meet him this time around.
He's a super dude. We're going to be seeing him in a couple weeks when we get out there for May Mania. We're looking forward to that trip. We got a ton of trips coming up. Where are we going to be seeing you next?
Well, I'm on a team with my son at Spring X.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm going to try and hit Covington, Tennessee, May 20th. And then Bash for Cash, I'm in the Joker wire class. And then after that, it's Metal Mayhem.
Man, you're piling up the miles. Do you have any aspirations of going to Utah or getting down and running in Topeka at Blizzard Bash?
Well, I talked to Gumby and he said there's an open invitation anytime I want to come out there and run. So I'm kind of got to try to figure out how to fit that in there because that'd be a cool thing. He told me there's probably between the first week of August and the end of September, there's $500,000 in prize money in derbies in Utah.
That's
accurate. Crazy.
It's completely different world out there.
Yeah, that's crazy. But and hopefully we're doing a build car the day of Blizzard Bash this year. A bone stock car.
Nice. That's gonna be exciting. So this year you're gonna be right in your average. You're gonna probably be around 25, 30 derbies by the time you're done.
I think so. Yeah.
We gonna see
you. I do a handful of local shows here in Ontario.
Yeah. I know last year you snuck into Dunkirk for a night. We saw you at the San Filippo show. Are either of those two shows on your radar?
Absolutely, San Filippo. We're going to run that extreme.
Oh, right. Jeez, I was thinking, I got that crossed up with Wheel Days. Are you going to be coming to Wheel Days at all?
Possibly. I might even want to go back to Caledonia. I had fun there running against them Suicides in a stock Crown Vic.
Right. Everybody knew you were there.
That's for sure.
there's no doubt. Everybody knew you were there. And I'd hope that you can sneak into Dunkirk as well. I know we're gonna be doing a bunch of those shows. Did you go down? I'm trying to remember now. You went down and ran in Florida too, right?
Yeah, I finished second to Mad Mike down there. I forgot to do one thing on my 4.6 Vic, and it went into limp mode, and I couldn't pick on him. So,
jeez,
just things you do when you're in a hurry,
right? I can't get over the fact that you've been in all these different states already. We're an easy 2 months into the season when you count February up to present, and you've got so many runs under your belt already with so many more to come. You guys are going to be busy up there, but I know you can pull it off. If anybody can do it, it's your crew up there.
Yeah, we have a lot of fun, and you might as well do it, right? If this is what we love, so, and I don't mind the driving, like when Urban Destruction was over, went out and shook some hands and hit the road and drove home 11 hours.
11 hours isn't as much as I thought it would be.
Yeah, and we're just working away. We got some, our Spring X cars are in the garage and they're coming along really good and can't wait for that.
Spring X is going to be a good time. Who else is on the staff? I know we talked about your son. Who else is helping get those cars together?
I have a guy that helps me out, Matt Boyd. He's a really good worker. He doesn't know a lot about the building part of it, but the stripping part of it he's really good at, and I can always count on whatever job I give him, it gets done.
Well, I know there's a demand for those Ford motors overseas, and as long as you're filling containers, you got to do something with those shells, and it sounds like you got a pretty good plan going for yourself.
Yeah, I got 40 of them here, and I'm thinking about having a sale on them real soon so I can move some out because there's a whole pile more that are coming up, and I want to buy them all.
You got 40 shells right now?
40 rolling cars. 15 of them are stripped and ready to build.
Wow. Well, if anybody's looking for Crown Vicks, give Bad Ronnie a call. He'll be able to hook you up. Again, winning the Mad Dog Award in the heat and punching your ticket right to the feature and finishing second in the feature Mad Dog voting to Derek Shelley. Derek's a guy that you don't mind finishing second to. The car that he built out there for Urban Destruction was unbelievable.
Oh, that car was crazy.
You ever build anything quite like that?
I think my first car back in 1979 was a 63 Mercury Monterey, and it was pretty cool.
Really? That is cool.
Yeah, I won with it, too. So.
That's awesome. And you got a pile of those trophies, and more of them are becoming Mad Dog Awards because everybody looks forward to seeing you run and bringing your style of driving to the shows. And I'm excited to hear that you're going to be making it out to New York a couple times.
Oh, for sure. I love it down there. So hopefully maybe we can make it the Kings of Old School, too.
Excellent. Well, Ronnie, I mean, is there anything that we missed? Anything that's coming up that you wanted to make mention of?
No, all's good. Life's good, and I just love to smash cars and hope I can do it as long as I can walk.
Perfect. Well, I like the sounds of all that, man. Take care. Be careful.
I appreciate all the good work you guys do.
We certainly do try, Ron. We appreciate the support, and we'll be talking with you soon. Good luck at Spring X.
All right. Thanks a lot, Chris.
We'll see you later, Ron. There goes Ron McClung taking the Heat Mad Dog Award and punching a free ticket into the main event out there at Urban Destruction in Evansville, Indiana. Second place in the overall voting in the main event, the championship round out there. We were talking a little bit with Spinning Wheels. We're going to get those guys back on the phone here momentarily, give you a rundown on what their schedule looks like. Spinning Wheels Productions, we talked about the San Filippo Smash. Before we get there, a lot of action to come ahead of it. May the 6th is the FTR Spring Showdown at Booneville Onieda Fairgrounds in Booneville, New York. 20-car limited weld main, $1,500 to win. Economy V8, $1,200 to win. Compacts are $1,000 to win. June the 17th is the Spring Fling for Jeremy Gulley and Spinning Wheels. It's at the Otsego County Fairgrounds in Morris, New York. Limited welds are paying $1,200 to win, plus Economy V8, Economy Compacts, and the trucks. Truck rules universal across all the Spinning Wheel production shows. August 3rd and 5th is the Otsego County Fair, also at the Otsego County Fairgrounds in Morris. Two-day show there. August 4th is the Wayne County Fair in Honesdale, Pennsylvania. That's home of the Wayne County Fair. August 25th is the GDS Fair at the GDS Fairgrounds in Newfoundland, Pennsylvania. And then the San Filippo Smash. Moving into September, one night only here in 2017 at the Otsego County Fairgrounds in Morris. That is going to be an October date. But there's a wedding that weekend, so Jeremy had to move that backwards one weekend only for this year. That is going to share a date with the local show here hosted by Wayne Ellison at Paradise Speedway. Let's see. Up next, Blizzard Bash, blizzardbash.com. You can jump online and find more details there. That thing sold out wicked quick again. The Epic Derby happening one more time out there at the Kansas Expo Center in Topeka, Kansas, and under contract through 2020. Excited to be part of that one with Smash It Demolition Derbies. Qualifying rounds for the national and qualifying bracket. Team round ones are going to be November the 10th starting at 4 o'clock. Friday, November the 11th at 9 o'clock in the morning is the RC Derby, and then 6 o'clock national and qualifying team round two, and the 14 to 17-year-old youth division is on deck after that. That's, again, Friday, November the 11th. Saturday, November the 12th at 10 o'clock is the doubleheader, so to say, morning and afternoon sessions planned. Compact limited weld team round one at 10 o'clock, and then at 6 o'clock, the Power Wheels, all the Team B mains, the trucks, the youth, and the bone stock all scheduled to go off again at 6 o'clock. And then Championship Sunday on the 13th of November, 1 o'clock start time for that one. National qualifying limited weld and compact Team A mains all planned for that one. Again, details and agendas, you can find them online at the Mandan team, BlizzardBash.com. And that's for Blizzard Bash 2017. Jumped ahead of myself there. Mandan team show Saturday the 10th of June. Awesome hard-hitting show. We're going to be bringing that to you on pay-per-view. Ken Hoff is your contact over there, 701-391-6211. We're going to be talking with Dustin Anderson here in the coming weeks to get some more input on that one. And a number of teams taking shape. I know Sam Bando is going to have a team up there as well. Looking forward to catching up with all those guys as we get closer and closer to that Mandan team show at the Dakota Speedway on Longspur Trail in Mandan, New York. They've got a Facebook group. If you just punch in Mandan Team Derby, it'll bring you right there and get you all the information for that one. Bash for Cash is right around the corner. We're just over a month away from that one at the Ross County Fairgrounds in Chillicothe, Ohio. We're going to be out there for Saturday and Sunday. 80s and newer and turn back the clock and compact division, all paying over $10,000 or more approaching. I think we've actually gone over that 500 entries point at this juncture. Ron McClung says he's going to be in the wire class. Weekend passes for adults, $75, kids 6 to 14 or 30. Single day passes are $30, and they're only available on Sunday. You have to buy the weekend pass if you're going to be catching any of the live action Friday or Saturday. You can find more details on smashitderby.com. Again, Bash for Cash at the Chillicothe, Ohio, Ross County Fairgrounds, May 26, 27, and 28. Smash It is also going to be giving away Baldwin engines at Blizzard Bash 2017. All compact drivers are going to be eligible with 5 tickets to win a Baldwin 3.1. And all the full-size drivers are going to be eligible with 5 tickets for a Baldwin Racing V8. And let's see, next in line as we work through all the places that we're going to be going and some of the proud sponsors that we've got with us here this year. Midwest Smash Fest 2017 in Geneva, Nebraska. That's going to be July the 15th, 2017. Midwest Smash Fest being hosted by Chad Bumgarner. And it's shaping up to be an absolutely awesome show. We talked with Brent Clemens last week. He's excited to be out there as part of it. They've got some new news that they wanted to release here in the coming week. So we're going to be talking with Chad about that one. Again, that's July the 15th. Fresh cars only, two-man teams, $125,000 purse guaranteed so far, and that's just the team bracket. There's other classes beyond that. $20,000 for the first place team, $15,000 for the second place team, $13,000, $11,000, $10,000 back through fifth, and they've got a very, very ambitious payoff schedule planned out deep into that team feature. And rounding it out, May Mania, that one is just around the corner as well. We're about a month away from that one, May the 13th, 2017, Golden Spike Arena in Ogden, Utah. It's a two-man team derby. They've added the two-man truck heat. Total prize money, $42,500. Stern Dirt Racing outdoing themselves again. They've got a really, really busy schedule this year. It's looking like we might be out there a couple times to hang out with those guys. Again, May the 13th for May Mania. We saw an awesome show there last year. It's proven that this is going to be even bigger. They're talking about all sorts of great improvements. I don't want to let the cat out of the bag before we get Johnny on the show to sort of release that in the order that he wants that information made available. But the two-man truck heat, excited to see that one too. That's going to be a lot of fun watching Dan Bolton making his first run out there with Team Easy Does It. And Paul Cox at the Golden Spike Arena in Ogden, and excited to be bringing that to you on pay-per-view as well. So, letting you know where we're going to be, where we're going, and a little bit about some of our conversations, where we've been as well. I'm going to try and get Jeremy Gulley back on the phone now, so bear with me while I dial the phone. Probably the most riveting part of the podcast, watching me dial that. Nobody here tonight. I'm not sure where everybody went. I didn't hear from Josh at all leading up to tonight. I know he's been working on his truck pretty actively and posting some pictures, taunting Jeremy Gulley, if you will. Josh Decker posting those pictures. Jeremy back on the line with us. Jeremy, can you hear us all right? Can you hear me, Jeremy? Jeremy Gulley. Hey, Jeremy. Jeremy.
Hello.
We got you?
Sure.
You there?
Oh, there he is.
All right, perfect. got this all straightened out. Jeremy, have you seen any of the pictures that Josh has posted of the trucks that he's been working on at home?
Yeah, I did.
Those all going to pass? That's okay, what he's doing out there? Or what at least what he's having Jerry do out there?
I'm actually headed to Decker's here in just a few minutes, so I'm going to... He says he's going to cover it up with a tarp, so I can't see it.
Yeah. If you're heading over there, you're going to be there for a while, pointing out all the stuff that's done incorrectly on the front end of that truck. It looks like it's going to be pretty vicious.
Well, that's the thing, though, Chris. I've actually put together a pretty rugged set of rules, I think. I could build a pretty damn nice truck to him. Because I want guys to be able to run every show that we have with...
Right.
Very little bit of no rule changes per se,
mm-hmm.
but hopefully just maybe add, after it's run the first time, they're going to get their fix-it plates and they'll be able to add a few fix-it plates to try to maybe straighten it out enough to be able to run an entire year with them.
Right.
Is my plan, that way guys can, cause it's hard to pay trucks big money. You don't
sure.
know what's going to show up. And if you only have five trucks, it's hard to say $1,000 to win.
Absolutely.
But, if you got four shows that you can win and they're $500 a piece and you can run the same truck at all five shows or four shows and you happen to come away with a win at all four, that's $2,000.
Right. This actually picks up right where we left off before we lost you here just a few minutes ago. Is what's the response been to the unified rules? We've heard good things. We've heard rebuttal a little bit. We've seen some promoters try it. We've seen other promoters come through your area where they're running the same set of rules every place. But then some folks are trying to push the issue and they're not playing, so to say. by the rules and keeping that level of parity. What's the response been to your ear about a unified set of rules that are the same at all of your shows, stretching from pretty far north into New York down all the way into Pennsylvania?
Well, first of all, a unified set of rules is only going to work if you, in my opinion, of course, this is
right.
My opinion as a driver, if the unified set of rules allows you to build the car enough that it's going to last more than one or two shows, then it's all well and good to have a unified set of rules.
Sure.
If the rules are stocked to the point where you're going to make junk of a car every run, then there's no point in having unified rules because you have to rebuild the car anyways.
Right.
So it's not really the biggest thing that we've come up against with our is with our limited weld, because Spinning Wheels has taken kind of some of the Out West ideas and brought them to New York.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's not many places allowing a Tran brace. There's not many places allowing a homemade bumper. But you know what? I've seen a lot of guys doing crazy and cool stuff that they've never done before.
Right.
And some of the guys are really enjoying it. I mean, who's ever Leaf converted a metric Petty before? In New York, not many.
Right.
I know of two that are being done now, and guys are loving the new rules. So, you know, the biggest thing we've heard is those guys that really like to run super stock shows, mm-hmm. and they don't want to, even my economy class isn't really a stock show, but it's by no means a crazy, wild build. It shouldn't take you more than 3 to 5 days to put the car together.
Sure.
So
while Middle America...
My biggest thing is loaded bumpers in New York. You know, a lot of guys are worried about the doors, you know, the skins and everything else. Listen, you don't have to run a loaded bumper. I'm not telling you you have to. It's an option.
Mm.
I'm sure guys are getting tired of paying, you know, $200, $250, up to $500 for bumpers, for God's sakes.
Right. I mean, what's your take on running a piece of box stock and putting a skin over the top of it?
I don't have a problem with that.
Yeah.
I really don't. Not many spectators are listening to the podcast. There are a few, but mostly drivers.
Right.
What I want is I want the spectator to be able to sit in the stands and say, well, that still at least it resembles a bumper. It's not a Mad Max bumper.
Right.
I don't have a problem. I think our rules allow you, if you're running a pre-73 skin, which would be a skin without a backing,
mm-hmm.
you know, if you wanted to take a 71 Imperial bumper or whatever and put a piece, I think our rules, don't quote me on this, read the rules. I think it's a 5x5, 3/16 piece of square tubing, weld it to the front of your bumper, and then weld your skin on it. My loaded bumper rules state that it has to have a factory back, a factory front. I don't say how it's got to be attached. I'm not telling you what to do, but if it's got an aluminum backing and it's zip screwed to a piece of tubing, it's attached.
Okay.
Okay?
Yep.
We're just going factory fronts, factory backs, and the 74 and newer bumpers. Anything under 70, you know, 73 and older, if they want to run that, they can run a piece of 5x5, 3/16 square tubing. And it doesn't cost a bunch.
Right. And that bumper's going to last a whole lot longer than one of the ones that you pay upwards of $250 for.
Well, yeah, and if you take your time and make a few gussets in the right spots, you don't have to load a bumper and make it super, super heavy.
True.
You know, just put a few gussets here and there, close up the fronts. Because if guys make the mistake of putting a 350-pound bumper on an economy compact, it's going to absolutely destroy the front rails.
Yep. It's too much.
And they only make that mistake once.
Right. You know,
just because you can close off a bumper and load it full of concrete doesn't mean you can't or you should.
Right.
And that goes with a lot of our rules. Just because you can do something doesn't mean that you should. You have to still stop and think, is this going to hurt me more than it's going to help me?
Sure. Where Middle America and some of these big shows, you see the trend going more towards stock. You reference bringing some of those ideas from out west back home. Are we still on the upswing where guys want to go to a heavier build, or have things begun evening out on the coasts with where they're at in the central part of the of America? Because we always hear people say, well, out in New York, out in Pennsylvania, they're 10 years behind where we are. Is that starting to even out a little bit more? Is everybody sort of settling into this limited weld, extreme stock type build?
Well, I think we're still behind.
Mm-hmm.
It's a cycle, Chris, and I think we're actually catching up with Ohio, you know, 5, 6, 8 years ago. And
right.
Our guys are just starting to say, well, if we do this and this, well, we can do this, you know. And unfortunately, now the Midwest has got away from that bigger build, and they're going back to a more stock for either car count reasons or whatever. And we might actually be doing the wrong thing. I don't know.
Right.
We still do have the economy stock, and we still do have a lot of guys in the areas that we run the derbies here that want the limited weld cars.
Mm-hmm.
We allow Imperials in the limited weld. So where a lot of the Out West shows, they don't allow the Imperials or Suicides. And now they're, I've even heard talk of the Caddy making the list of not allowed cars in a stock show. Well, and that's, unfortunately, that's not what I want. I'm leaving the unlimited weld class open to any car. The economy class is there's no Imperials allowed.
Mm-hmm.
But I did that only because I fear that our area has so many guys that love to run imps that it would, that allowing Imperials in the economy VA class, I fear, would hurt the car count overall.
Could you run an 81 or 82 Imperial in the economy class?
Yes.
You could do that?
Yes.
Oh, well, it gives them an option then. I don't know why you would, but it's an option for them, right?
Well, sure it is, but that's just an Arbot. That is junk.
In terms of the promoter's perspective for you, Justin, you've seen a good round of support for your economy class. Your compact class has been strong. Where are you at in terms of the build? Because you guys go, in addition to promoting shows, you guys drive as well. Where are you guys in terms of the build?
For me personally, basically where we have the rules now for the county V8s and compact. Basically where I would want to build a car, because it doesn't take too much, but there's enough there, like Gulley said, that it leaves you room where you could actually run your car more than once.
Sure. And I'm sure that Bernard Huxley likes those plans, because that gives him an opportunity to roll people over in the same car multiple times.
Touching base on the unified rules, we are running the same limited weld rules as spinning wheels, so anybody that runs our show will be able to run, the next show will probably be Morris on June 17th.
Perfect. In terms of FTR schedule, are you guys looking to just stick with one show, or are you going to expand this year?
Actually, there was talk of us taking over two fair shows next. It probably won't be this year, obviously, but next year. The Booneville Fair itself and the Loudville Fair.
Is that something that you guys want to do now that you got your feet wet and the promoting thing has been going, for all intents and purposes, it's been going smooth and you got good response from the driver base?
Yeah, I mean, I enjoy doing it. It gives you a lot more insight of what the drivers, really want on car builds and what they expect from the promoter himself.
What's been the biggest eye-opening part of this in terms of, first year going through it, getting it done, and trying to implement the changes that all these people are asking for? And now as it gets closer and closer, you've got more and more people offering more and more input about more and more topics.
Well, you can't make everyone satisfied. We had a lot of input, what we should do for the rules, but trying to keep them all unified, so kind of meet in the middle with everybody, what everybody wants. First year was definitely hard. We kind of came up with a set of rules, that we thought might fit everyone's needs or what they wanted. But as far as, I think everybody was pretty much happy the way it went. Like I said, we didn't really have any complaints on how the first show went.
Do you find yourself almost at times, this is for both of you, Jeremy and Justin, do you find yourself almost at times trying to protect the drivers from themselves in terms of what they're asking for and what they want to see out of the rule book?
I myself try to. It's extremely hard for me not to. I get a picture in a message or something in an email, and a guy says, well, I want to do this. I try not to ever put myself in a position to tell somebody that there's no way that it's going to work.
Right.
I've been there, I've done that. So I try, but I try to, you know, they got to make their own mistake. The young guys do. They got to do things their way. You know, as long as it's within the scope of the rules, that's fine. But, you know, go back to the bumper roll, like I said, and, you know, I've had guys call me and say, well, we want to run a solid 6x6 piece of metal on the front. Well, I guess if that's what you want to do, have at it.
Right. How about you, Justin?
Yeah, I get a lot of those, like Gulley said there. People ask you, well, can I do this or can I do that? I mean, we've done quite a bit of it. I mean, you kind of got to leave it up to them on their interpretation of the rule itself. I'm not going to sit there and tell them, well, yeah, you can do this knowing, you know what I mean, that maybe that's not the right thing. I don't want to point anybody in the wrong direction on what to do. And I'll kind of just leave it up for their interpretation of what they rule, kind of, right. You know, without... I don't know, I'll go too far with that, I guess, I should
right.
say.
We're not trying to build a handbook of how to build a dirt car. We're giving them a set of rules,
right.
And you have to interpret those rules through social media and the ease of contact anymore. I don't even get phone calls hardly. I get 15 Facebook messages a day.
Sure.
You know, and
yeah.
I try to answer them to the best of my ability and get to everybody. You know, but again, I didn't build a... This is how you build your derby car rulebook.
Right.
Handbook.
You both took that question in a different direction than I was expecting you to, actually. I was thinking more of the planning phase of the rulebook and all the drivers trying to weigh in as we should be allowed to do this and we should be allowed to do that. And you're talking strictly in interpretation and build process, you know, actively putting the car together and saying, hey, is it okay if I do this? Do you find that to be where more of the questions come from? Is it just crickets when you're putting together the rule book and you get more of the questions through the process of building itself?
Well, when I did the spinning wheels rules, I sat down, I got a group of guys together, all former drivers. I got together with Dustin Minotti, who is my head inspector.
Mm-hmm.
I got together with Kyle and Ray Baker, which Ray Baker has run old iron longer than I've been alive, probably. and I took, I got David Chrysler, who is pretty good with the metrics, the metric caddies, and I got with Brian Leonard, who is obviously a compact guy, and I got Josh Buell's here for some of the old iron, and he's built materials, and he's, you know, he's even built new iron. He's never run it. But,
right.
Then, of course, with the trucks, I've relied pretty much on my own past experiences with that as far as rules go. So when I got together my rule book or my rule set, it was through the drivers, through respected drivers, and I messaged a few other drivers in Chad Winnie, talked to him a little bit about it. I talked to some drivers from out west that I had conversations with as far as, you know, because we are implementing the trans brace. How do we mount the trans brace so that it's specifically for and used as a brace for guys to stop cracking cases, and it's not used as a K or as a, an additional kicker or as a pressure point mounted off of the steel bowel, which is attached to the steel, you know, the distributor protector, and which is attached to this, which is attached to this, which is attached to the bumper.
Right.
We try to not have everything up front completely connected. So I relied on some guys out west to tell me how to do that and how to go about writing the rules for that. And so that was a big help.
Interesting. How about you, Justin, when you're putting your stuff together?
We pretty much, after looking through the rules or spinning wheels, that's what we pretty much went with.
Yeah.
The only couple of changes that we made were basically on the compacts. I had a few drivers, you know, ask me about doing this and that. But basically, body mounts was probably the big one, and allowing all thread for the hood, which they can kind of take their own interpretation of how to run the all thread. Just
right.
Can't run it right through the frame itself, but.
Interesting.
The economy rules and the limited weld rules and the truck rules are, I believe, identical to spinning wheels.
Oh, cool.
Yep.
The compacts, they're allowed the front body mount, I believe it is, they're allowing them to eliminate that front body mount where spinning wheels has to have a factory bushing.
Well, that FTR show, again, right around the corner, May the 6th, Booneville Onieda County Fairgrounds in Booneville, New York. 20 car limited weld main, 1500 to win. Economy V8s, 1200 to win. Compacts, 1000 to win. Sounds like it's going to be a good one. And then after that, we get on planes and fly out to May Mania. We're going to see Dan Bolton running in that team truck derby. I mean, the season is already actively in full swing. Jeremy Gulley was making the trip down south here in the coming days, talking about bringing back one of the raffle cars that's going to be given away at New Year's Eve, and we certainly appreciate the efforts you put into bringing that thing back. Have you pinned down a car yet, or are you still in the hunt?
No, we're still looking. We got lots of time.
there's definitely lots of time. That's for sure. We got to figure out what direction we're going to take that thing for this year anyway, but I know one way or another we'll find a way to make it happen, so I'm looking forward to...
I got to go look at a couple. I got a 76 Caprice. I got an 81 two-door Crown Vic.
Nice.
There's a few lined up that we're headed down toward. I'm leaving here on Saturday and headed down towards Hilton Head, North Carolina. And we'll see what old John Furr's got lined up for me and see a few that I found on Craigslist. And we'll bring back something nice for the Crash Course Podcast.
Bash. Yep, it is going to be here before we know it. That's the unfortunate thing. Is as nice as the weather is today, man. Everyone's gonna be outside.
It got warm, man. Stop.
Yeah, I know. I'm not joking though. Think about it. It's gonna be bearing down on us quickly. This season is going to go so fast. We've got more travel planned than ever before. We've got more stuff going on than ever before. It's going to be a fun year, but it is going to go so far. I mean, Jeremy, you know yourself. Look at how your schedule has just kind of blown up, and you're turning stuff away.
Yeah, I've got the three big shows. My tough week is going to be that first week of August because I got Morris on Thursday night. We had a Fulton County Fair at Morris on Thursday night.
Yep.
Then I fly right to Honesdale, Pennsylvania. We do the Honesdale show Friday night. And then back to Morris at the Otsego County Fair on Sunday for a really full, busy schedule Sunday afternoon.
Right.
So that's going to be a week from hell right there. But once I get past that week, I'll be all right.
Yep. And are you still doing? Is it still going to be three shows in 2 days at Otsego County? There's going to be two shows on Sunday's program.
Yes. Yeah. There. As of right now, the Sunday. The 1 o'clock is going to be basically all heat, all the economy V8, the limited weld V8 heat will be at 1 o'clock, and then there will be a concy for the economy V8, a concy for the compacts, a concy for the limited weld V8 at 6 o'clock, and then we will run all the features as well as the full weld truck feature at 6 o'clock.
Awesome. It'll be a fun one. Guys, I appreciate you finding some reception and being able to get back to you and finish our conversation tonight. Is there
thank you, Chris.
Anybody that you guys wanted to make mention of before we get out of here?
Really just, you know, there's a few sponsors that we've got. Rogers Poly Insurance out of Honesdale, Pennsylvania. CJ's Cans, CJ's Restrooms out of Honesdale, Pennsylvania picked us up and sponsored our youth show down in Honesdale, so that was kind of nice, and So that's kind of the two that I've picked up thus far. I don't know if Justin's got any for the FTR show yet nailed down or not.
No, not really. Not at the moment.
No.
Just some sponsors for the trophies, but they'll be right on the trophies themselves. I don't have a list of it with me right now.
Perfect. No problem at all. Well, if anything else comes up of interest, be sure to let us know. Guys, thanks a lot for coming on the show and working through the technical stuff.
Chris.
And we'll be in touch. Sure. Good luck.
Thanks.
We'll see you later. There goes Justin Hartmann and Jeremy Gulley. That's going to do it for episode number 176 in the books. We'll see everybody again right back here next Monday. Quick programming note. Just for everybody, as we come to the top of the 7 o'clock hour, there will be no shows on Finger Lakes 1 from the 27th of April through the 8th of May as we move into our new facility. So we'll keep everybody abreast on that. Perhaps we'll find a live remote to do, because that is going to cost us a Monday at some point. But we'll follow up with all that when we get a little bit closer. Just wanted to put that bug out there in everybody's ear. That's going to do it for this one. We'll see everybody again right back here next Monday.
The Crash Course Podcast is brought to you in part by DerbyParts.com. The 2015 Ladina Grand Slam. Boat Lockwood Motorsports and the 2015 Keystone National. Sciopa Racing and SciopaRacing.com. Ultimate Derby and Blizzard Bash 2015. Demo Derby Master. Reckless Abandon Derby Apparel at RecklessAbandonGear.com. And Derby Inc. Magazine. Live it, breathe it, be it. Derby Inc. This is the Crash Course Demolition Derby Podcast, recorded live at the FingerLinks1.com studios in downtown Seneca Falls, New York.